briefly explain the format of this. So it's described as a panel discussion, but in fact each of our panellists has a short presentation to start with as well. So we've got three very contrasting approaches to biography represented by our three panellists. The first person who's going to speak is Graham Favolo, who's a science writer and communicator who's written the biography of Dirac. The second person who will speak will be Sydney Padua, who's written, she's a graphic artist by trade, but has recently written a graphic novel about Ada Lovelace and Babbage. And then finally, Nick Bingham, who is the maths obituaries editor for the LMS, is also going to speak. They'll each give about a 15-minute presentation. There'll be time after that to address questions to them individually. And then at the end of all three presentations, we'll do some general chat about the purpose and nature of writing science biographies. So without further ado, I shall pass over to Graham to give the first talk.
Thank you, Colbert. Thank you, Isabel, for organising this conference. It's fascinating for me to hear the breadth and depth of different perspectives on mathematical biography, and a little humbling to be actually invited. I'm very grateful for the invitation, because I'm neither a mathematician nor a seasoned biographer. I've only ever done it once, so I still have a great deal to learn. Now, in these brief remarks, I wanted to give my own particular perspective on my experiences of writing a cradle-to-grave biography of a mathematically-minded theoretical physicist, Paul Dirac, which I chose, of my own free will, to write simultaneously for two audiences, namely, one, the theoretical physicists who see Dirac as the very first example of their genre in the 20th century, the theoretician's theoretician, as he's sometimes called, and otherwise, regular people who buy books. Now, that I would quite happily agree is an absurd statement, right? To appeal to both of those things might be regarded as quixotic or even crazy. But there we are. I chose to do it, and I have some reflections on that on that notion. I might add, right, because to underline the perhaps foolishness of it, the book had to be a commercial proposition. Again, I chose not to go through the university presses, but to go through an organisation that would market the book and get me onto the media and what have you. That's not intended to make me lots of money. No, no one. What does Johnson say? No one but a blockhead writes except for money. But it was to get the notion of Dirac and his work out into to the field. Now, the origin of my particular project, I can pin down, actually, reasonably accurately. This vision here, this is 12 Fairview Drive, Orpington, Kent. And I saw pretty much exactly that view, slightly different car, slightly different window, right, when I was a 15-year-old in the spring of 1968. And I walked to that door, trying to sell a raffle ticket. That was my intention, that this was to fund my burgeoning record collection at the time. And those of you who were around then will know this was a very particular time, because this was the afterglow of the Sgt. Pepper era. I walked up to that door, knocked on it, and I met somebody who I only see occasionally now, but was one of the most influential people in my life. This is a gentleman by the name of John Bendall, who is, as far as I know, a completely anonymous figure. He's a government mathematical physicist. Now, the reason why this was so singular was because this gentleman here is a 24-carat Dirac fanatic, totally obsessed with Paul Dirac. Every Christmas, John Bendel reads The Principles of Quantum Mechanics, Dirac's classic book. He almost cannot go 10 minutes without introducing Dirac into a conversation. Even if it's about the price of artichokes, Dirac is in there somewhere. It's no coincidence that his younger daughter was named Paula. He introduced me to Paul Dirac. And it was 34 years later, not quite to the day, but to the month, that I embarked on writing a Dirac biography. And I can tell you where that was, too. That was on the SS Great Britain in Bristol. And I'll tell you the date. That was the 8th of August, 2002. Why? Because I was in Bristol talking at the Dirac centenary about his famous equation. And it was there that I met Dirac's younger daughter, Monica, We got on quite well. 10-minute conversation, and I thought, right, I'm gonna have a go at this. So, with all the enthusiasm of a desperately amateur beginner, I embarked on that project. And I might say it was only really viable because of somebody whose photograph I don't have here, by the name of Neil Belton, who was then an editorial director at Faber Books, who really was and is prepared to go for, if you like, big ideas and enthusiasm, not for what's going to make us the most money in the shortest possible time in the Christmas market. So the whole project is indebted to him. Without him, it wouldn't have happened. And I still say that if you went today with a similar sort of venture to most publishers in London, they would calmly show you the door. So what were the challenges of writing this book that I had to address and Neil had to address when selling it to his colleagues at Faber? Well, the first thing is that, roughly speaking, nobody's heard of Paul Dirac. Yeah, of course, illustrious in theoretical physics. Outside, nobody's heard of him. Many times I went to Bristol and I made it a kind of popular game for myself, asking cab drivers if they knew who Paul Dirac was. One knew. I think that was in 3-4 years of visiting the place. Compare the number of biographies of Einstein, unarguably a great scientist, Oppenheimer, a good scientist, not a great one, dozens of them. Richard Feynman, very good scientist, Stephen Hawking. These people are extremely well known, and publishing houses are very, very happy to keep generating more and more biographies of these very considerable figures. The lesser known figures, that takes a lot of selling, and that's why I'm indebted to Neil, because he did that hard selling. The other thing is that Dirac is exceptionally boring person. So, and I'm quoting here, certainly from Martin Rees, my friend Martin Rees, former president of the Royal Society. When I told him I was writing a biography of Dirac, he told me not to do it. I've still got the email. Dirac is, according to Tom Stoppard, rightly, always uses words very carefully, the stick figure of early quantum mechanics, by which he means there that it basically wasn't really a person, just basically an assembly of lines, so to speak, not really a person at all. Third, he was mathematically minded, right? That is an anathema, right, to the publishing world, by and large. You do not, mathematics does not sell. Okay, John Nash. There's always odd exceptions, but if you're looking in the horrible market that commercial people work in, of probabilities, you don't invest in mathematics. And fourth, perhaps worst of all, is he was British. Now, why do I say that? That's because a lot of the commercial sales of books goes into American sales. And Americans are basically genuinely interested in Americans, plus Winston Churchill, whose mother was, of course, American. Now, I'm being a bit flippant here, but if you don't believe me, the person who bought the rights for the Dirac book, her name is Laura Heimert, she will see this online, she was given a dressing down by her boss in his office for being so stupid as to spend, whatever it was, $30,000 on a book about a boring English mathematician who nobody's ever heard of. That's a true story. Now, my challenge, when I finally got the commissions are on work and got invested in by Faber to write the book, was to tell the story of how this chap, this was in his pomp in 1931, picture never seen before in public as far as I know, Paul Dirac in Princeton, without doubt seen as perhaps the hottest, one of the two or three hottest physicists in the world, not perhaps the best dressed one. Here he is in his co-op suit, standing with his back to Princeton University. I had to give my readers a sense of why this person was worth knowing about, and hit the trajectory that took him from being this cherub in, I know, lovely picture, isn't it? In Bishopston in Bristol, where he was born in 1902, to the traditional position of the elderly mathematical physicist, which is to be patronised by the younger generation. It's something Einstein had, and it happens to most people. I can tell you their names now, but this happened to Dirac as well. One slight obstacle that I had was that there was actually a biography out there by Helga Krog, industrious, distinguished science historian, who wrote what is technically called a scientific biography, which means it concentrated on his scientific output. And I still commend Helge for the depth of his work done in the pre-internet days, because that's very different to the ones that we have now, when everything is, or so much is available online. But I knew that Helge's book was not going to be one that was going to be sold in the regular Waterstones. But that was my challenge to try to do that. Now, other challenges. First of all, Dirac himself was the driest possible person in terms of his attitude to mathematical physics. He regarded, in his young days, something you just couldn't talk about equations, because they just were. You couldn't possibly aim to talk to Times journalists, Guardian journalists that called you, because it was just something you didn't talk about in the public. You just did it with experts. And I resolved, following the Hawking model, right, to basically cut the number of equations down to almost zero, which again, I can understand. I have been attacked by this in public. I knew that although you can occasionally get away with it, Roger Penrose has done that once or twice, but once you start including serious mathematics in a popular book, you really are narrowing your audience. We can discuss that, and I'm happy to talk about that. Okay. There are lots of fixed ideas about this gentleman. But quite often, senior physicists will sit me down and tell me what I have to write. Sometimes they completely disagree with one another, except in their arrogance. The Dirac stories, I won't tell you any now, I haven't got time, but Dirac stories are more famous than Einstein stories. Every physicist has to know a story that talks about the singularity of this gentleman's behaviour. I began by believing none of them. I wanted ocular proof, as Shakespeare would have said, that they were true. And of course, the big challenge for me was to balance his personal life and his scientific life. I wanted to give an outline so that your Melvin Braggs, your Tom Stoppard, your Ian McEwan's would read the book, have a sense of why this person was so revered, and also a sense of this human being who grew up in humble circumstances in Bristol, who came to be involved in this rather singular field. Now, it's only possible because I had the most remarkable luck. I've done other projects when I had nothing like this luck. I've seen other people, much better writers than me, that have had no luck. But on this one, I was lucky. First of all, archive. This gentleman left a garage full of stuff, right? I embarked on the project not knowing that. That's an idiotic commission. True, though. I had a wonderful staff at an archive. Not always true. Some archivists are pains to deal with, right? Those ones were not. Secondly, he had family and friends. He had friends who were alive. They're now all dead. And they talked to me. One flew across America with a PSA count so frightening you'd think he wouldn't get on an aircraft, just to share his last recollections with me. Even now it makes my heart miss a beat. His family, his two daughters, were prepared to speak with me. Perhaps the biggest moment in my professional writer's life was when Monica, his daughter, put on a kitchen table in front of me and said, well, there's a couple of hundred letters there he wrote to his fiancée. You may be interested in them. What? Absolutely unbelievable. Third, institutional support from St John's College, where he's their greatest scientist of the 20th century, and the Institute of Advanced Studies that really supported me. If you don't have that, and if you're an amateur like me, it's very difficult, actually, to write, to invest a lot in a biography. And, of course, his amazingly colourful family life, which I can talk about over dinner, but not now. He had the most remarkably colourful father, the most remarkably colourful wife, effectively his antiparticle. Right? And they even had the courtesy to die. One died and one came into his life within 2 months of each other. It was like a playwright had written it for me. It was quite remarkable. So, with all that luck going on, I was given a fair wind, I think it's fair to say. And I was pleased that when the book finally came out, it did have a resonance. I have to say, though, lest you think it was all plain sailing, at one point I had the most damning letter I've ever received from Faber saying, this book is not published. They said, there's just no way this book's going to sell. Right? Now, they changed their mind, but I've had that letter, I've had that. Right? This does happen to people, right? Anyway, it did get published. I'm very pleased about that. I'm still not convinced it had the reach for popular audience I wanted. David Attenborough once came up to me at lunch party and said, I read the book, but it reminded me of how much physics I really find quite difficult. But it did reach a lot of physicists. I can't complain about that. Very few were patronising about its content because they realised that I was aiming for a wide audience. One was incredibly patronising in a Dublin theatre, but I won't talk about him. It could easily have been a disaster. I have to say that, right? Because there are. I'm looking at the moment for another topic, and I can see disaster written over quite a number of other possible stories. I was fortunate mainly that there was a really big science story. That's what I did know. Tremendously rich narrative. I didn't know that. Incredibly lucky that those papers survived, didn't end up at the bottom of the Atlantic or in an incineration of the family papers. And mainly because the family were prepared to cooperate. That is not always the case. I might say that less than a month before I met Monica, this gentleman's wife died. Monica had just driven from one side of America to the other. And after the book was published, I said to Monica, do you think your mother, that's your ex-wife, would approve of this? And she said to me, she would veto that out of hand. Thank you very much.
Well, as I said, we'll have quite a lot of general discussion at the end, but if there's questions specifically for Graham, let's do them now.
Yes. I'm curious, you said you're looking for another topic then now.
Yeah.
So what was it about this experience? Was it something about this experience of writing this biography that has you now ready to do your second biography?
No, I love doing it. I love biographies, political, even show business ones. I love Claire Tomlin and Michael. Michael Holman, the guy that wrote the Shaw biography. I love reading biographies, and I want to write another one. Right, but it's you need luck. You need luck, in my opinion.
If you were to summarise in one sentence, what would be your main points in that biography?
This is a very cruel task. The whole book in one point. All right, I'll give you Dirac's point. It's a long sentence, okay. But it shocked physicists, right? Said to me by both daughters, right? This was a long sentence, I'll take a long breath, right? If I could do it, anybody could. All I had was good teachers, great universities, and the luck to be in the right place at the right time.
Oh, awesome.
He said that more than once. Plenty of physicists did not believe he would say it.
Yeah. When you were selling the book to the publisher, you didn't describe him in the way that you were describing us. Why did they want this book? It wasn't because he was the most boring character ever. It wasn't
no,
because...
No, it was that.
What?
No, as I said, this is why I wanted to underline the role of Neil Belton, who is a singularly intellectual publisher, in all seriousness.
Right.
He knew, because he's very well read, that Dirac is rated very close up there.
Rated 2,840.
Wikipedia, I mean, please. Among the professionals, right, Dirac is right up there, right, and there is such disparity between how well known Einstein is and how Dirac is, right, and he was prepared to take a gamble on this person's life, not knowing that personal stuff, and very generously on me as a novice biographer, so he deserves a lot of credit for it.
So this is slightly more general about writing biography and the next generation of writing biographies. And you came into a very large tranche of personal correspondence.
I did.
Whereas the Dirac of my generation's personal correspondence will be password protected and on a completely dead
iPhone. Very good point. Very, very good point.
And so how do you think that's going to change?
It worries me a lot. Every time I go to anywhere associated with leading scientists, and of course we don't know actually, maybe other leading scientists in 30 years' time are not going to be known now, but I spent a lot of time at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, where there are four of the best scientists, physicists in the world, and I constantly say to them, you could actually have all their correspondence if they let you, right? But maybe you don't want to have the argument with your spouse available to the public, you know? So, I mean, I wish more people were doing this. Just a comment that you'll know that Gordon Brown's archive, which has gone to Churchill College, Cambridge, which I'm a full disclosure, I'm a fellow of that college, right? That is mainly, almost entirely digital. So we're starting, But it's a very pertinent question, and I really hope that archivists start paying attention to that.
Great.
Let's thank Rome again for that, and then thank you.
Project sort of work, and I think the animator and the biographer actually have very similar tasks in that they take dead material, disparate dead material, and try to create out of it an illusion of life and vitality out of that. So that's sort of my theme here. If you're not familiar with my work, centers across these two guys, A. Lovelace, Charles Babbage. This is supposed to be about how we approached biography. I did not so much approach this subject as I was ambushed by it. I was asked to do a very short biography in comic form for Ada Lovelace Day in 2009. Ada Lovelace Day, if you're not familiar with it, is an online festival for women in computing. Most people didn't know at the time who she was. I didn't know who she was, so when I was asked to do this little comic, I went to Wikipedia, looked her up, and found this crazy story. Only daughter of Lord Byron, raised as a mathematician, met Charles Babbage. I hit this point in the comic, which is a very short comic, it's about 8 panels long. And at the end of the story, she dies at 36, and no computer's ever built. And just as an ending, that didn't seem to have the landing that I wanted. So just as a joke, I drew the following last panel. This was, I think it was an allusion to the fact that Lovelace and Babbage have lived on very strongly in steampunk and in sort of fictional worlds that imagine this computer actually being invented. So this was the end of the comic, a lot of people saw it and assumed that it was actually going to be a comic about Ada Lovelace and Charles Babbage fighting crime, which at the time I had no intention of doing. This was a joke. But 2 days after I put the comic up, it actually showed up in Wired blog saying, "This person is going to do this comic." I was like, I think I was thinking about the Avengers, by the way. So I started, just because I was putting off working on something else, I also became sort of fascinated with the story. So I started this blog very informally, just as a hobby, I guess, more than anything else. Just playing around with the characters in this world, in this idea. So in this comic, they fight crime, obviously. But as an animator, the first thing I do when I'm handed a subject is I look for what we call reference. So if I'm animating a tiger, go on YouTube and look up every single video of a tiger, trying to find an interesting gesture, what the essence of the movement of the tiger is, the anatomy of the creature, what's underneath the skin, so then I can recreate it, revive it on the screen. So with them, I started browsing around online. And at the end of each of these comics, which were very improvised, very loosely sketched comics, I started adding notes The notes were 90% just links to primary sources I found online. And in terms of being at the right place at the right time, I think no one has ever been at a right place at a right time than I was with the subject, because I began the comic almost simultaneously with the launch of the Google Books project, which began to dump these huge amounts of 19th century ephemera online. And that suddenly put me in a position to stumble across just absolutely incredible amounts of stuff that had not been seen before by scholarship. Reason being, which I did not know when I started the comic, that Lovelace and Babbage were hugely famous in their own time. So this is actually from the Deseret News, it's from Salt Lake City. 1890, which was much later than you'd think Babbage would be, sort of the sort of person that you'd put anecdotes as a filler newspaper story in, but there he is as the famous problem solver. An egotistical talker, which a lot of people agree on. What I found with all these things, this is memoirs of Lady Eastlake. Lady Lovelace apparently tended to bore people talking about mathematics at parties, which is why we're saying Babbage and not Byron should have been her father. And it's from this ephemera that I began to draw a picture of them, much more than from, I read secondary sources, of course, but from the secondary sources gave me a very different picture of Lovelace and Babbage than this material of the people who knew them as physical humans in the world. The other thing I found was that computer jokes almost immediately became a really popular thing to make. This is possibly the earliest crashing computer joke, 1851. This is actually a huge long piece in Blackwood's magazine where Mr. Babbage's machine, which is now imagined as this actual enormous thing, has a crash. Finding all right to put the screw on, and all went well till a loud crack was heard just as the indicator was beginning to register in the left hand and a pretty stiff figure. Both the integral and differential calculi had cracked. So this physical machine in the period, already the imagination was, the period was fired by the idea of this enormous calculating machine, which shows up actually a lot. These are just samples, but the other thing I found online, and this was a real turning point for me actually in terms of them as people, and this is what makes Google Books such an incredibly valuable thing. This is the sort of thing that you would never find in a million years as a scholar looking specifically for Lovelace and Babbage stuff. This is a letter from the Southern Review, which is a very strange and short-lived journal from Maryland in the 1860s, published in the wake of the Civil War for about 3 years. And this is just a letter that a local person wrote home. He met Charles Babbage, they have some mutual acquaintances. And there's this enormous passage of Babbage a couple of years after Lovelace's death, describing their relationship, very, very vivid descriptions of Babbage and his sort of warm friendship with Lovelace. And by far the most vivid picture, I think, of them in their relationship. And nobody would have ever been able to find this without a Google search, unless you were, for whatever reason, looking in this incredibly obscure journal. The importance of this letter, I think, would have been missed. So, and that's, you know, speaking of citizen science and non-scholars, that's, I think, the sort of democratization of crowdsourcing, at least for looking for stuff like this that Google Books brought. So people, the other thing that, as an animator, I sort of brought, so once you've done all your reference in animation, you have to transform it. We're not really looking just to take the real and present it as the real. This is why I'm not a biographer. You want to find some sort of transformative space. This is Babbage, 1851. I was really happy to see this because I actually found this after I had done a lot of, sort of sketching of this character. Babbage is very easy to write. He's a very, very, if you've ever read anything of Babbage, I would recognize immediately if anyone had read his stuff, because you'd have this sort of fond smile on your face. He's a huge personality in his books, of which he published many, many books. So his personality comes out, and, you know, to me, because I'm an animator, it comes out in the form of gesture. So as a gestural figure, he's very, very clear. In terms of why I did this particular subject, so moving from the reference, and now we're transforming this into something else. For me, what I found really interesting about this was all the thematic resonances, all these dualities of the male and the female, the machine and the human, the ambiguous and the certainty of mathematics, all of which appear very much in their stories in so many different ways. So I use tarot cards a lot. Lovelace actually referred to herself as the High Priestess of Davina's Engine. So she comes out very clearly as this sort of murky, mystical figure. So just as an example, as a sample sort of way that I approach sort of the storytelling here. So this is my favorite by far document. This is the New York Mirror, 1833, same year that Lovelace met Babbage. This is one of these sort of news and weird columns that they used to put in American papers just for a space filler. It is said that Ada Byron's sole daughter of the noble bard is the most coarse and vulgar woman in England. Which I find delightful and such a great picture of her. She did swear a lot. She very much liked to shock people, so I think that's where that's coming from. Something else I was sort of reading at the time I came across that was these two descriptions of Babbage's error pop up. Babbage's machine, which is an incredibly beautiful machine, we'll come to it in a sec, had a pop-up, error pop-up if you put in the wrong card. It said wrong. Later he added the continually ringing loud bell if you made a mistake in your punch card operation there. So these two together, I got the phone. Yeah, this is Lovelace debugging the machine, vociferously. So I guess that's my approach to biography, such as it is. All the stuff that I do with comic is just finding stuff from their real lives and transforming it. I think all biography is transformed by the biographer and by the biographer's expectations, what the biographer is, what story they're trying to tell. So between that and the facts, you know, the biography tries to find a balance. I didn't find a balance at all. I just had facts and then the crazy stuff. And then between those, some people have to find their own balance, I guess. So this is Babbage being kidnapped by the organ grinders, monkeys. He had this famous war with the street musicians. So that's what's going on there. And Lovelace's addiction to poetry is sort of based on her opiate addictions in her own life. Just finally, just get through. Quickly here. During this entire project, I have to say, and I've been doing the comic online informally for about 5 years before I did the book, I was very, very conscious that I was an interloper in this world of mathematics and computing and biography. So I had a desire to give something back. The analytical engine is sort of the third character in this book. In the comic, it appears as this vast labyrinth of gears that people get lost in. This is George Eliot getting her manuscript spell checked. she gets a little turned around in there. So when I sat down to do the book, because I had this balance of primary documents, the imaginary Lovelace and Babbage, and then the real ones in the primary documents in the footnotes, I thought, okay, I have the imaginary engine, now I'll get the real one in, and I was started reading all the stuff I could find on the analytical engine, trying to find a nice image of it that I could steal, and I was horrified to find out there wasn't one. So I spent about 6 months on this, to the horror, actually, of my publisher, because this was not what I was supposed to be doing, but Babbage left all these plans. I should say this would not have been possible without Alan Bromley's work. Alan Bromley, Babbage scholar of the 1980s, who did a lot of work in interpreting Babbage's plans. He did not, unfortunately, leave very many visuals. So, fortunately, I do have, this is my job, my day job, is doing stuff like this. So, I could sort of put the plans in and start doing elevations, which was by no means simple. The actual figuring out of the machinery wound up completely obsessing me. So this is, to the best of my knowledge, the analytical engine. And so I found it's this kind of odd kind of trip that I started with the documents and created these very, very imaginary characters, and then wound up back, in a sense, at the real machine through this sort of process. So anyway, that's my friendly talk on this approach.
One short remark. So if you want to look for more newspaper articles, like for 5 or 6 months there has been an online database where you can search American newspapers.
Huh?
It's extremely helpful. You just enter a search word and it pops up. So a lot of sources. And I also have a question, because you mentioned that she was quite famous at the turn of the century and a little bit earlier. And now the woman I work on, of course, has also been very famous. And she pops up in a special form of sources, which is basically people just lining up biographies of female scientists or female mathematicians. But never have I encountered, except in very voluminous books, but in these short ones, I've never encountered Ada Lovelace's name.
Huh.
Not once.
This
and
is
I'm kind of confused by that now. Because, and I wanted to know whether have you found like short article where they named 5 or 6 women in mathematics and Ada is one of them?
There's one, to my knowledge, from I think 50, very shortly before she died, maybe 49, 51. Mechanics Magazine, which has not been digitized fully, has a list, for some reason talking about the suffrage movement. I have no idea why Mechanics Magazine is referring this to, but there's a little shout out to female mathematicians, and
yeah.
Lovelace is in there. But aside from that, like in her own time, she was hugely famous as Lord Byron's daughter.
Yeah.
She published her sole paper not under her own name, it just had her initials on it. And the other thing is the importance of the paper, you know, which is that general computing theory, wasn't evident to anybody until at least the 1970s.
Yeah.
So Ada Lovelace, the mathematician, is a very, very recent, recent thing.
But still, you had some sources from the 90s where they alluded to her, and it seemed like people should have known who she was, in a way.
Well, she's alluded to often as Babbage's friend. Like,
ah, okay.
They show up as a duo a lot,
because
I guess they hung out, and the contrast between them might must have struck people the same way it struck me. So people would have anecdotes about the two of them.
Okay.
Right, we should probably move on to the third talk. So our third brief speaker is going to be Nick
Graham.
Nick, you've not got slides, have you?
No, I was here for a panel discussion, so I thought I'd envisage myself sitting at the front of the MLS talk. So I never stand at the front of the MLS talk. I love the last two talks, and I'm going to kick off by saying things suggested by the last two talks. So far as Sydney's talk is concerned, these error messages that the analytical engine is supposed to produce. When I was a researcher, I was so grateful that I wasn't in lab science. A lot of my drinking companions were in lab science, and they used to weep into their beer because they had to use computers to process their data. And in those days, it was done on punched cards.
Mm-hmm.
Now, ordinary riffraff, like research students, weren't allowed access to the machine. The high priests were the operators, and so they had to take a stack of punched cards and give it to the operator. The following day, they'd get it back with an error message saying it didn't run. Now, imagine trying to check a stack of punched cards how people kept saying, I simply don't know. But they did. And the other thing that I can't resist mentioning, because it was the analogue 100 years before that of punched cards, was the Jacquard loom. How many of you here present have seen a Jacquard loom? Please show. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted, because the Jacquard loom dates back to the history of the United Kingdom as an industrial country. I am no jingoist, believe me. I am very proud that the UK, before it was the UK actually, pioneered the scientific revolution with Newton, the agricultural revolution with Jethro Tull and the seed drill, the industrial revolution with James Watt and the steam engine, and I am comprehensively and thoroughly ashamed of the fact that the UK pioneered the de-industrialisation revolution, which older members of the audience will remember. I better not say any more about that, partly because I'm short of time, and partly because you don't want to see a grown man reduced to tears avoidably, do you? And by the way, I love the style with which you rendered your Ada Lovelace character. It captivated. Look. You've seen Cats, have you?
Cats?
Cats. The musical Cats.
Oh, musical Cats.
Yes. Have you read O'Possum's Book of Practical Cats?
That one, right.
Right. Look, you could make a Cats out of Ada Lovelace. And if you do, I want 0.1% royalties. Good. I cannot resist, before I get on to what I intended to say, to talk a little about what Graham's talk put into my mind. When I was a research student, Dirac was still alive, and I was surrounded by people who knew Dirac well. And the one thing that surprised me about your talk, Graham, was that you heard all these stories and you didn't believe them. I heard them all, and I do believe them. Look, Dirac couldn't have made anything up if he'd tried. And I don't believe that people lie, ever set eyes on him, he was in the States of it. But the Dirac folklore is more reliable than the folklore about any normal person, because Dirac was such an abnormal person, he couldn't make anything up if he tried. Very interesting character. Right. Let me get back on brief and talk I forgot to look at my watch.
I'll wear you on.
Yep, very good. And talk about the writing of mathematical biographies. The most operative thing there is writing. Now, I'm a mathematician by trade. There are better mathematicians out there, says he grudgingly through gritted teeth, but none of them can write better than I can, I might. The number of mathematicians who can write decent English prose is tiny. That's the problem with writing mathematical biography. Most mathematicians can't write, or if they can write, they don't. And if they could, they think they could. That's really the problem. Writing for whom? And again, this surface very dramatic in what Graham spoke about. Graham was writing for the general public, and Dirac had zero interest in the general public. Dirac was a theoretician's theoretician, a compliment that one of my physicist friends paid to my friend Chris Isham, retired professor of theoretical physics at Imperial College. And it's a wonderful compliment, a theoretician's theoretician. That was the way. I read the Dirac biography you mentioned, and I heard or read, I actually can't remember, that thing that you said was the quintessence of Dirac. He said that anybody could have done it. The reason he did it was because
Carl's Tunty Tum Tum.
Great teachers.
Great teachers.
In the right place at the right time.
Great universities, mm-hmm. and in the right place at the right time. He was a physicist by original training. An engineer, excuse me. Simply slip of the tongue. An engineer.
And mathematician.
Yes, and mathematician. And were mathematicians. Dirac famously said of mathematics, and the essence of mathematics is proof. Dirac used to say, if told that his proofs were, his arguments were rigorous, I do not care about proof. I care about what nature does. That's the essence of Dirac to me. Back to writing mathematical biography. Who is one writing for? Now, this meeting is held under the auspices of the British Society for the History of Mathematics, and many of the members of the society are mathematicians, and quite a number of the members are not mathematicians, but they have a cultural interest in mathematics. Now, the extent to which you can make contact between something as special as mathematics, or any other hard science, or exact science, quote unquote, and the general public is a very difficult question. Most famously, Stephen Hawking did it, and when Hawking was writing A Brief History of Time, he was told that for every equation he put in, the audience would shrink by a factor of two, and he went ahead and wrote the book, and it was a smash hit. You know this. It can happen. I hope that you are just as fortunate, sir, as Stephen Hawking was, and that the general public goes for what you write. Dirac would have been astonished to find himself even a candidate for the subject of a book aimed at the general public. That's by the way. Why can't mathematicians write? One reason is because a lot of mathematicians get fed up to the back teeth with having to write essays as school children. And then they realize that if you do mathematics, you don't have to, quote, write essays, unquote. You can duck that. And they do. And then the ones who are both good at mathematics and have mathematical staying power hang in to the point where they have to write projects for, let's say, final year, let's say, master's course, and then later on, write a PhD thesis, and then later on, start writing for publication, and they have to write. And it's like bringing blood out of a stone. It's really problematic for them. That is one of the underlying problems about writing mathematical biography, is mathematicians and writing. Now, I served 10 years as the obituaries editor of the London Mathematical Society. And the bane of my life, and the bane of any obituaries editor, I suspect, is actually getting obituaries written. And there are all sorts of reasons for this. The most obvious one is that we live under brutal line management these days, and senior academic administrators tell the foot soldiers of academia, people like me, that they are not supposed to concentrate on what they find interesting, they are supposed to concentrate on what will boost the institution in REF, Research Excellence Framework for those who have to cope with this sort of thing. Previously it was called the Research Yes. And so on and so forth. And way back when I was a lad, back in the Stone Age, when people used bows and arrows, way back then, you did it because you wanted to. You had an inner compulsion to do it. You did it for reasons of scholarship. If you mention scholarship to university administrators, these days they don't know what you're talking about. Then, yes, right. Okay. I'd better be very brief then. Right. Yes. And writing mathematical obituaries, what is the balance you're going to strike between breadth and depth? No mathematician knows all of mathematics in adequate depth. If you're going to write about everybody, you have to be Edwin Robertson, and I'm not. The people that I have written about, with confidence in myself, were in the 20th century and in my neck of the woods mathematically. I'm a probabilist by trade, and I'm also an analyst come statistician. And that's fine, provided one is writing for publication in things like festschrifts or memorial volumes or whatever. But if you're writing for newspapers, people who drop off the train, they don't oblige you by dropping off in your own subject area. You get phoned up by the editor of such and such a newspaper, and that really is a challenge. And thank goodness for sources like Mad Sinet, the internet, and the existence of live people who knew the subject and you can phone them up and say, Joe, have you got 10 minutes? Your distinguished colleague such and such has just dropped off the tree and I've had such and such a newspaper on to me, etc., etc., etc. That's really how it's done. Depth versus breadth. Nobody knows everything. He who knows everything knows nothing. This is a play on words. He who defends everything defends nothing. Do you know who said that, ladies and gentlemen? Frederick the Great, saying much admired by the late and unlamented Arnold Petty, always goes through my mind when I'm thinking about breadth versus depth. And thank goodness for hypertext. And am I out of time, madam chair?
Not yet.
Well, that's right. Hypertext is wonderful. Take, for example, Niels Henrik Arnold. Now, everything that has been written by Arnold needs to be updated every time a good new book on Arnold is published. That's hypertext. And we've had a lovely talk on Arnold here at this, at this conference. I meant to buttonhole a Scottish academic to ask them about the Royal Society of Edinburgh, which I'm not going to inform you about. But there is a thing called the Royal Society of London, more familiarly known as the Royal Society. And when fellows of the Royal Society drop off the tree, eventually they have full-length treatment, biographical memoirs of fellows of the Royal Society. Even that, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes takes an embarrassingly long period between the death of the subject and the appearance of the study. It's got to happen, and I've been involved in the birth pangs of one of the longest lasting of these delayed BMFRS things. It's awful. So it's not just the London Mathematical Society that has trouble in getting things ready. It happens even for the Royal Society as well. So far as the LMS is concerned, we have, if you like, a three-way split. FRSs get biographical memoirs. The humbler members of our profession get a piece in the newsletter, which is basically a death announcement and a one or two paragraph summary cum appreciation. And the obituaries for the LMS are published in the LMS bulletin and tend to be intermediate in length and intermediate in aim and scope. What the Royal Society of Edinburgh does, I simply don't know. Do you know it? By way of mathematical obituaries.
They publish mathematical obituaries.
In which journal?
They publish the yearbook.
Ah, thank you. Yes, the yearbook of the Royal Society of Edinburgh.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. In general, given that you both here sitting down, I'll ask whoever's answering at any given point in time to please stand up. Grab the chairs. So I guess first of all, does anyone have any questions for Nick since he just spoke? Yes.
So do you have any advice for mathematics programs about how to incorporate writing, maybe what we would say at the undergraduate stage?
Oh, you mean mathematics curricula?
Yes.
For students? Okay. Two comments. First of all, I think you're asking about projects. but secondly also about the history of our stuff. I think it's really both. Now, does one have room for both in a typical undergraduate program? The history of mathematics is not as widely taught in the UK as I wish it were. On the other hand, now that we have moved from a three-year first degree to a three or four-year first degree in the UK, that happened over the last 20 years. And since there, quite rightly, has been much more emphasis on transferable skills, most good mathematics curricula here in the UK do have a project element for credit. There was a time when academics used to say, students will not do anything except for credit. Now, that's no longer true. Way back, students who felt that their IT skills were not up to scratch were desperate to get their IT skills up to scratch. They didn't care about credit. They cared about being able to look interviews and apply when they had to go out and put themselves on the job. And similarly for things like writing projects. Most departments have a project program, and the projects are logged internally. The extent to which the project marked is fed into the eventual student classification varies from university to university. I have no doubt. Does that address your question?
Thank you. Great. So, does anyone have any general questions to the panel? Tennis.
As I said, you've written quite a number of obituaries for the Times of mathematicians.
Yes.
Were any of them written in advance of the person's death? Or were they all hastily got together at the end?
Some of them were indeed written in advance. Some of them were done with as much haste as I could muster. And I vividly remember being a guest for Sunday lunch with my wife's best friend and her family. And I was summoned from the lunch table and did the fine tuning of it, walking around this family's back garden many years ago. There is an element of urgency about obituaries, and there is a standing tension here. On the one hand, an obituary is more acceptable to the public if it is of a person whose death is topical and current. But on the other hand, the longer you've got to mull over and fine-tune and dig, the better an obituary you will get. And it's a question of balance. And really, I think it depends on what the outlet is. For a newspaper, I personally think that it's better to be topical, because after all, you haven't got much length of it. 800 words is about the norm, I would say. But for something with a longer shelf life, then topicality is less important than getting it right. Peter Neumann, who set up the LMS Bulletin, always used to say very proudly that the LMS Bulletin was a journal of record. And if you're writing for a journal of record, you want to get it right.
Yeah.
May I just make a comment about the question about how to write?
Yes.
Yeah,
now, I'm certainly not an expert, but may I just put this forward, that there's a danger in over-intellectualizing, just as mathematics is learned by doing mathematically, so writing is learned by doing. And so the first thing I would say about how to write is do it.
Yes.
And the second thing, of course, is to discuss it and to read it. And just as polio perhaps might be a Bible for how to do mathematics, because it tells you about blocks, there's this excellent series of articles by Paul Howells. One is called How to Write Mathematics, one is called How to Read Mathematics, and there's a third one, I forget what the third one is. And so that would be, not the last word, but I think that might be the first word as an answer to that question.
John, I'm thinking of Polio's book, How to Solve It, or I'm thinking of...
Polio's book, yes, How to Solve It.
How to Solve It. I can't resist this. How many of you have read How to Solve It by George Perry?
Well, it's not a reading book. It's a dipping book.
I picked it up. I couldn't put it down. It is the only short, simple book that I would say any mathematician, however good, who hasn't read that book will become a better mathematician by the simple act of reading the book. It is a masterpiece. And to me, it's not a book to dip into. I'd like to reread it. Mm-hmm. I read it like a detective novel. I couldn't put it down.
I'd just like all of you, maybe in turn, to say what your ambitions were in terms of your audiences by writing what you have done. It might be a bit more difficult with the histories, but are you trying to stimulate your audience's interest in history of mathematics, or what's the main purpose of your writing?
I think almost entirely innocent of thinking of audience through the entire process of both creating the blog and writing the book. I'm not a writer by trade, I suppose you'd say, and I also hadn't approached either project as being audience directed. I was writing for myself, researching for myself, because I was doing out of my own interest, and as it turned out, there was a lot of overlap between my own interest and that of the general public. I think, to a surprising extent, people really love the detail of that stuff. So, rather than trying to imagine an audience, just wrote for myself.
Well, that sounded a bit similar to you. You got hooked on the story first, and the audience had to follow.
Yeah, I'm just going to repeat it myself. You know, I wanted book to be read with pleasure by physicists, but I also wanted it to be read by people who are curious enough to want to be able to read a story about that. I ought to say here that if you're writing, you never say never, but in most cases, if you're writing the kind of thing that I'm writing about, the original wizard, you're not going to get Harry Potter-like audiences. You're just not. But, you know, just to name some people that's in the public domain, if you can imagine your Tom Stoppard, your Melvin Bragg type person, there are many others but people like that who don't know anything about it but are prepared to give you a fighting chance. They're the kind of people I had in mind that one might be able to read. It's not everyone, though, I have to say.
I myself, being a professional mathematician, write for people in the hardcore mathematics public who read mathematics journals. I mean, that's not the same as writing.
Didn't you also say you wrote for the Times?
Yes, but my more heavyweight stuff is aimed at mathematics journals. My writing for the Times actually was done anonymously. Because the Times obituaries are not signed. Guardian obituaries are, Independent obituaries are, and I believe Telegraph obituaries are. That's from memory, because their defence correspondent, the chap with the Dutch name, I remember his name. I actually went public on my Times obituaries fairly recently, when my Festschrift was published. So. Previously, nobody knew who had written.
I found a list of your Times obituaries on your website recently.
I think I took it off because I thought that my CV on my website was too long and that I should prove it. I'm seriously thinking of knocking out a long list of conferences that I've given talks at. Less is more. I'm becoming more of a minimalist the older I get.
Very good.
I'll probably prove.
Mark, you can make the question.
For Graham, I guess. And so there's an enormously prolific theologian at Oxford called Alistair McGrath. And 2 or 3 years ago, he published a new biography of C.S. Lewis. Of course, Lewis has had many biographies written on him. But he put a huge amount of effort into reading through the entire corpus and then published effectively 3 books on Lewis. He published a book for the general audience,
yep.
A book for an even more general audience, potentially, of thematic matters, C.S. Lewis, The Breakfast Table, and then a hardcore book called The Intellectual World of C.S. Lewis. So he kind of tripled up on his work. What do you think of that? And B, if you think it's a good idea, would you be willing to do it for Dirac?
No. That's a good question. No, it's a very good question. I mean, if you look at the classic media training business, then that makes a lot of sense. You do a lot of work. It took me 5 years.
Yeah.
A serious 5 years. And then you produce a book, and if it doesn't work, then you're left with just a dead turkey, basically. Right? But your model there of doing... channeling to different audiences is, I think, very, very. I couldn't face going back again and doing it. But I mean, it seems a perfectly. You know, I'm sure other people will take my subject, maybe do it better. But I mean, everything is a gamble when you go into to writing. And I have to say, because these people, some people as I'm going to describe now, don't often have their voices amplified, but they're a superb. Examples of lives of great scientists and mathematicians that are completely ignored, right? because they don't reach a wide audience, and that to me is very sad, very disappointing, and that's one of the reasons, perhaps the main reason, why I wanted to write for a public audience, because someone, in my opinion, I don't want to get on my high horse, but there is a cultural reason why society, which to a large part is responsible for investing in the sort of thing that theoretical physicists do. They need a bit of payback, in my opinion. That may sound naive, but that's what I believe. I like A Thousand Flowers of Room. I love technical biographies of mathematicians, and I read them with great pleasure. Right? But what I'm saying is that business I'm in is writing for a wider audience. It's as simple as that.
Thank you.
Slightly shifting from the audience thing, I was wondering if the three of you could talk a little bit about how much of yourself you think you wind up revealing through the process of writing these biographies.
I remember many years ago writing a reference for a candidate, for a job or for a promotion, I can't remember, and a wise man who sat on the panel said to me afterwards, you know, references reveal just as much or more about the person writing the reference as it does about the subject of the reference, and similarly for obituaries. It's one of the things I made a note of while Graham was speaking. I forgot to say it because, Madam Chair, I was terrified of overrunning. But it's absolutely true. And indeed, every age has its own vision of each key figure.
Yes.
It's true in science, it's true even more in politics.
So, what tells do you think you've made whilst writing? What have you revealed about yourself?
What have I revealed about myself? Well, just what I've said here today. I probabilist, I do analysis and statistics, and I finance my sins, maybe they will quote me, and history of mathematics, and I love writing. But everybody who knows me well knows all that anyway. Does that answer your question?
Something that really struck me fairly recently was that I wouldn't have thought of this remotely as a subject that I would be interested in to begin with. I mean, I hate computers. I very famously took ages to move from hand-drawn into computer animation. I wouldn't have said I was interested in Victorian history at all in any way. I mean, it just seemed so random when I started it. And I've been doing it for about 5 years before it suddenly occurred to me that my father, which I hadn't made the connection at all. My father's a sociology professor, but his specialization was actually in statistics. And sociological statistics is something I make endless fun of in the comic. And I suddenly recalled, which I hadn't, a memory which I hadn't thought of in years, which is that, of course, this was the 1970s, and he had one of those little Curta calculators, which was a thing I was absolutely fascinated by. I was constantly rescued from my little grubby hands when I was a child. So I think, you know, these sorts of subjects that you write about, it brings up a lot of subconscious stuff, but it's something you're not aware of, I think, until you
Absolutely, undoubtedly. A biographer is a tyrant in a way, because he or she selects certain material, discards a lot of stuff. I mean, just to take my case, I had enough material easily to write two full volumes, right? But there's no way that would get published in the market that I wanted. So I had to, in fact, I took my first draft, it was cut by 30,000 words, which I was quite happy to do, but that, there's a lot of selectivity in there. The other thing, which we haven't perhaps mentioned, is, in my opinion, when you're out there trying to share with a broader public, no less intelligent than we are, but just not as knowledgeable about details, is the cultural reference that you use. And you have to guess what those things will be, right? Sometimes they're put to you on a plate, sometimes you invent them and bring them to the story. I remember in writing Dirac, I will never forget talking to Dirac's step-granddaughter when she told me that the thing that obsessed him most was Cher's television programme. I have people write to me saying, that's an invention. It's impossible. Just to answer your question, it's totally impossible. He had no interest in popular culture. He bought a new television to watch that show, right? Now, that's an example. I knew that I hit a gold mine there because I knew that people would, reading that introduction, would say, I can't believe this. Right, but I'm absolutely certain it's true. But you see, anyway, going back to the point that you need ways of linking with people to the regular world, right? But not a patronizing thing to do, but you need to make it fit into the matrix of the real world. And how you choose them is very much your choice.
It's visual. How many of you have been inside Westminster Abbey and looked at the Newton grave, which is in front of the rood screen on the left, and it is surrounded by five smaller plaques, one of which is for Dirac, and one of which is for Green. And I was present in Westminster Abbey for the laying or consecration of each of those stones, and there were memorable occasions, and that would be a very good visual opening. A television camera panning in on Newton's grave, the statue, and then the big Newton slab, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's how I would open a television camera.
Good question.
This is not my field, right? I'm a maths teacher who's gone to university and now works with other people who want to be maths teachers. And I've always felt that history is a part of what we do that we don't use well enough, and I don't know enough about. But what I'm fascinated about when I listen to you three speak is, in a sense of an addiction, and I'll take that the wrong way, when you speak about Dirac and the way that you speak about knocking on the guy's door, there's something that hooks you in to something. And with you, I find it fascinating, the differences, because with you it was about, you wanted more people to know. Mm-hmm. And for you it's about the creation of self and what you feel. So it's almost like you don't see the audience, it's a self-creation. And you work in such a different field and a different perspective. I'm just wondering, is it an addiction, finding something that you are so passionate about? And if it is, do you see different things and some of them don't work out? Because obviously you've talked about the ones that have. Do you get sparks, interests that you follow that then don't work out or you have to walk away from? Does that make sense? You say addiction. The word I will use is love. You can't do mathematics unless you love it. It's too hard. You can't do theoretical physics unless you love it. It's too hard. And love is such a powerful, motivating force. And I happen to be married to a non-mathematician, non-scientist, and she likes to know what I'm doing. And so I get regular practice in a marital setting of putting the guts of what I spend my time doing in words. And I think that is part of why I've always loved teaching history of maths. It's the only time I've ever been paid real money for a hobby. And perhaps that's what started me off. Once you start off, you sort of get used to it. It keeps you going. Keeps me going.
Just want to just not answer the question, if I may. Because to me, anyone who spends a substantial fact of life writing about someone they are interested in is crazy, basically. But I would say this, that I've often wondered what it must be like if you pick a subject, get into it, and find you actually don't like the person. That happened to us with Anthony Burgess's biographer. I happen to know that, who thought this person was a really ghastly piece of work, but had to deliver the biography. But I don't know of any examples of where somebody actually got into a situation where they found the person completely disliked. Maybe you don't.
Roy Henderson.
Oh.
And Lloyd George.
Yes, that's true. I heard that on the radio. Yes, he hated his writing. That's true. Not a mathematician, as far as I know. No, it's a good point. It's a perfectly fair example.
Yeah.
Well,
yes.
I mean, the main
addiction to theming. I think that's so beautiful because, if I was to sum up why I was doing this thing for so long, and it's not anyone who's ever written a book, and certainly anyone who's written a graphic novel can tell you it's not. but I loved them. I loved Babbage. I loved Lovelace, and I really loved The Machine. I couldn't tear myself away from that machine until I really understood it. Addiction might be a word. I mean, it's obviously some sort of brain sickness, but it latches onto something and you have to understand.
Get your agent to negotiate a contract to turn your stuff into Japanese comic scripts. The Japanese, I think it's called manga. The Japanese love this sort of thing. You make a bomb.
I just wanted to add the main Lovelace biography, I think the most scholarly one, was written by someone who clearly personally may or may not agree.
I was just whispering the same thing to Chris.
Yeah.
Tell us. What is it?
Lovelace is a lot of the way people perceive Lovelace. It comes from the fact that this kind of very serious biography was written by someone who clearly loathed her, and it's really extraordinary. Like, and so anyone who's read that book, it takes away this loathing of Lovelace. So it's generated this very strange aura around her. As a figure, and I couldn't think of how she got to the end of this book by someone she couldn't stand. Why would you do that? It's a very strange.
I just wanted to make a comment. I envy Sydney because she's unconstrained by the facts. And we can argue about what that means and philosophers do, but we would. Most biographers do claim to have some relevance to the facts. But let's put that the other way around. If you were writing a graphic novel about Dirac, or you were doing a graphic novel about
Dirac, I think I've had one musical.
After a few drinks, might have seen better.
Sorry.
After a few drinks, you might have a better answer.
A few? Anyway, carry on. Sorry.
No.
Actually, on a related note, Derek, all of you wrote biographies about people have written about people who are no longer alive. Obviously, obituaries very recently so, and the other cases somewhat further ago. How did you feel about dealing the dirt on them in some sense, revealing things to general public knowledge that they might or might not have felt comfortable about themselves?
Except I haven't raised at all, I want to just to stir things up here. Right. One of my flaws as a biographer is that I don't have that chip of ice in the heart that Graham Greene spoke about the novelist, right? And also, I like to think of myself as someone of my word. Now, why do I say that, right? I was dealing with Dirac's family, who were very, very good to me. When you get to know people really well like that, they take you into their confidence. Now, for most people in this room here, right, if you have someone you love, right, and you talk to someone, an interloper, you have to trust them, right? Now, there are certain things that they told me that I have not put in the book. I'm not saying he shot somebody or he, I don't know, did something terrible, but they didn't want, right? Now, you could argue that if I had a more professional person would have just said, to hell with it, I'm just going to do it. Right, but that is a compromising part of biography, which I will admit to. Right, but I think biography is inherently a flawed system in some way, especially if you're involved like that. One classic, forgive me to carry on, but there's one example we haven't discussed at all here. Siobhan Roberts' meta biography of John Conway.
Yeah.
Now, She was a friend of mine, superb person, lovely person, very fine writer. She not lived with him in the intimate sense, but lived in his ambit for years, which is something you don't do, right? But she wrote another, it's a very satisfying book. Now that's fascinated me that she could do that. But anyway, that notion of trust I think is something that needs exploring. Sorry, I went more second.
Yeah. Field Marshal Sir Douglas Haig, Lord Haig. How many of you have read Duff Cooper's Life of Haig? Two lawyers. Nothing extempore nor all set down in this. Haig was too important to pussyfoot about. Duff Cooper wrote a book which is not widely read these days because it was felt that he was too kind to Haig. The Song and Passion, that's all I'll say. And if only Duff Cooper, who was a fine writer, could have distanced himself more, he would have written a book which was objective enough to have stood the test of time. I only read the book because I read Old Men Forget by Duff Cooper, and I was so fascinated by it, I thought to myself, I'm going to read anything that man's written. And I just about have. But the only person I know who's read that book and appreciated it was my mother, who used to hate Haig's guts. But Duff Cooper was such a fine writer, he changed my mother's mind. He hasn't changed the minds of those who study military history, who think the book is valuable. That's apropos of the chip-a-lice.
Sydney, do you have any living relatives that you needed to obviously not immediate descendants, but
well, I mean, her great great grandson, I believe I've met him. But I mean, just as I, you know, by approaching the comic in such an odd way, I could avoid having to stick to facts. I can also, I mean, a big theme of the comic, I think, is that I make a very 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 clear split between the real people, who we can't know because they're dead,
yep.
And you know, them I present as far as possible in primary documents, and the imaginary people who live, they live in an alternate universe and are cartoons. So, but I definitely do feel, I mean, in a sense what I do is worse, because I've hijacked the real people into these caricatures. And it's terrible. And I do feel bad about it from that point of view.
No, no, they belong to all of us. You're exercising your right to interpret them in your own way. I'm glad that you just went for it. You did that.
I don't think they would have been glad, but they're dead.
Sorry,
folks.
Right.
I mean, loving and loathing is a big issue. It's also about critical distance, I think. Mm-hmm. But what I really wanted to ask, and what I think is probably specifically sort of an English-speaking, toward an English-speaking panel on an English-speaking audience, is I think that the wonder to what extent do you think that the audience or potential audience in the English-speaking world has changed through the publications recently. Simon Singh, Last Problem of Thermal, Longitude Problem, and so on. We seem to have a very receptive and intelligent audience out there, which is prepared to take on quite, technically quite difficult material and work with it. And I think, I wonder to what extent this is perhaps informed biographical writing these days.
Well, just briefly, I don't. It's not in my nature to be a pessimist, but biography is not flourishing in the true world at the moment. You just go look at the commissions. I'm not talking about big money here. I'm talking about a perfectly regular person in any field. It is not a hot field in literary publishing at the moment. Among scientists, I said that my gripe is they keep funding biographies of people whose stories are being told repeatedly. Occasionally, you do get. To get, but that's not an illustration of a general rule. If you ask me to take a guess, right, and it is just a guess, probably wrong, but I think Sydney's work is very innovative, and I can see it as that style or portraying something, I think could be something that in the more visual generations that are coming on would achieve greater and greater popularity. So I very much commend that.
I have a little comment that may or may not be helpful on this sort of the more what to do when you find skeletons in the cupboard thing. This all relates to Carl Pearson, I'll be alluding to some of it tomorrow. Certainly I've learned to love him less than I loved him when I started. I'm not writing a biography, I'm dabbling around. But I came across evidence, and initially it was not very convincing evidence, firstly of a hidden illegitimacy of the family, not Carl Pearson's father, I should say, secondly of a brother who died of syphilis. And I was in touch with the family, so how does one deal with this? Now, fortunately, I was able to find, as it were, a smoking gun that made me quite clear that there was clear evidence. And so I thought carefully about how to broach this. And, well, firstly, they hadn't known about it. Secondly, they weren't upset about it. But thirdly, this is the important thing, it rather felt them free to bring up other sort of family stories from their family history about, oh, there was another illegitimacy that we thought that great-granddad was illegitimate. And there were various other things that came up. So I was very glad that I mentioned it. But not that they were able to sort of verify the facts, as it were, but it sort of eased up the discussion.
But,
a whole lot of other
but you did get their permission. It wasn't a sort of going against their wishes issue.
Well, I mean, tomorrow is the first time I'm going to publish it, so we have to see. I mean, it all happened 150 years ago. So, well, 100 years ago in one case. So it's fairly distant. But I certainly did feel the unease. And I'm sure with somebody closer, there would be even greater unease.
I was just going to ask, what are your views on autobiographies written by mathematicians and scientists towards the end of their lives? I suppose my reason for asking this is
when's it coming? I cannot.
I got to know Benoit Mandelbrot quite well, and he actually wrote his biography in the last few years of his life. It was actually not published until about a year after his death. Yes. And I've been asked to review it for, I think, at least two publications. And I started to read it, and I could just not get past page 20. It's, if you came across Benoit Mandelbrot, you realise that, well, some people might say he was arrogant a little. And it just comes over in the extreme in the book,
yes.
And I just don't know whether he did himself any good service at all by writing that rather than leaving it to someone else after his death.
Well, absolutely right. My favourite Mandelbrot story is how one of the distinguished French fractal experts began the talk once by saying, Mandelbrot. Then, now he can't say, I didn't mention.
But in the more general context, what is the value of distinguished scientists writing about themselves?
What Kenneth is alluding to is the fact that in my first book, I stuck a piece which was ostensibly about the development of probability theory in the last 50 years. But as I wrote it, it turned more into me and probability in the last 50 years. And then I thought to myself, well, what the hell? Just stick it in. And as I said, if a man can't stick an autobiographical piece in his own festdrift, whose festdrift can he stick in? Which those of you who love Hilton Sullivan will recognize as being lifted from Ruddy Hill. If a man can't disinherit his own unborn son. Whose unborn son can he disinherit?
I thought it was fought his own income tax return.
That's a hero.
No, fought his own will, that's fine.
Gina might quite a use of Babbage's working about.
Yeah, I mean, if I don't know if this will go for Mandelbrot, but definitely the entire existence of my book, it owes everything to Babbage's autobiography, which is... I mean, even the reviewers of the time were completely baffled and enchanted by this work, which is, egotistical in the extreme. Babbage's personality is, as I said, very notable in many ways. but very, I think not a lot of people could get away with it. Babbage was a wonderful writer. But what's interesting about his autobiography is he hardly mentions his work. Aside from pointing out how many brilliant things he did, he doesn't go into any detail at all on the machine. You know, he has no detailed descriptions of the analytical engine, no detailed descriptions of any of his mathematical work. It's just anecdotes, and just talking about how great he is. It's a very entertaining book, but I don't know how many mathematicians could have gotten away with that.
Very good. Any more questions for the panel?
I'd just like you to comment on the difference between being popular and being rigorous, or the two, because you're both popular and rigorous. slightly rose when you mentioned Dance So Well book on Longitude, which is absolutely not rigorous.
But fairly popular.
Very popular. Yeah. But I mean, popular doesn't make it good. So I would like you to, you know, comment on the two.
That is a much wider subject than just biography.
It is. Yeah.
Any questions, thoughts on
just to say, let's use this general topic here for our meeting. To write popular mathematics, certainly modern mathematics, is a very, very tough thing to do. I'm doing a bit of it at the moment in my book, and it's very difficult to do, frankly. Right? You go back to the time of Newton, Laplace, you can actually write pretty muscular prose about what those are. It's a superb mathematician, so there's no question about it. But when you get down to the level of abstraction that you're talking about in modern mathematicians, right, it's extremely occasionally, there's a great skyhook, like the Simon Singh book on the Fermat-Schwarz theorem, where you have a theorem there that you can explain to an eight-year-old, and then you can elusively talk about the proof and then the secondary proof. But if you talk about some of the things that win Fields medals now, I mean, there ought to be a prize for popularising those things. It really is extremely difficult, right? And I might say many of the mathematicians I know, right, mainly in Princeton, have absolutely no interest in that. They regard that as something somebody else does.
Yeah,
you can't blame them.
I had a friend who was covering the Fields medals, and she was almost crying at the laboratory.
I believe
trying to understand what was going on and explain.
I was just saying, in all fairness, that does not apply only to modern mathematics.
Yes.
You try to write about Renaissance mathematics before they had algebra,
okay,
where it was all done by geometry. It is.
Indeed. Look at them. That's a very good point. I mean, Newton's stuff, for example.
He did algebra. I'm talking about people before that.
No. Newton did geometric.
Yes,
right?
I know.
And I'm saying that as well. That's all I'm saying.
Yes.
Sorry, Isabel, was there something?
No,
I'm just saying. Sorry, I misunderstood you. In that case, I think the wine is ready at the back of the room, so maybe we should thank our three panelists.